So it's really a pleasure for me to be the first speaker here in this Consciousness Ultrasound course. And I don't know how familiar you are with Consciousness Ultrasound. So we need to start with some basics, some technical and clinical basics. And this is my topic for the next 30 minutes. This slide just shows you the various potential and indeed used current clinical application of Consciousness Ultrasound. Is just it's not really complete. It just tells you that you can use Consciousness Ultrasound in principle everywhere where you can also use unenhanced ultrasound. And I would also like to mention that it's not just a typical morphological assessment you may know from ultrasound. You can do much more. As Paul mentioned, you can use it in intervention to guide and to monitor intervention. You can do functional assessment, which is pretty much known in echocardiography, but you can also do it outside the heart. And last but not least, you can use it for quantitative approaches, especially to monitor treatments in oncology, antiangiogenic treatment, and so on. And you will hear a lot about all these things in the following 2 days. Before you can go into details, you need to know some basics. And this is what I will explain in the following. So ultrasound contrast agents are gas-filled microbubbles, very simple. And you may know that you can categorize it into different or three different generations. What I called the very first generation was a product Ecovyst, no longer on the market. Actually, these bubbles were not very stable. They couldn't pass the lung. And there was only one indication, mainly for these kind of bubbles, to detect a right-left shunt in the heart. So if you were able to see them in the left heart or ventricle, you know there was a shunt. So the next generation were more stable. The first generation, the product was Levovist, also no longer on the market. These bubbles were more stable, so you could detect them everywhere in the body. But you needed a high acoustic power ultrasound called high MI ultrasound mechanical index. MI is a parameter of the acoustic power. And then the next generation, this is the generation which is nowadays available. For these bubbles, you could use low acoustic power, low MI ultrasound. And the products are Sonovy, Optison, Definity, and Sonasoet. I hope you will forgive me that I will focus a little bit on Sonovy because this is a product which is approved in Europe for indications outside the heart, which is liver, breast, and vascular indications. The composition is quite straightforward. You need an active compound, which is it's called active compound. It's a gas. For Sonovy, it's sulfur hexafluoride. And you need a shell to stabilize this gas. And for Sonovy, it's a monolayer of phospholipids. And you may know or remember that these phospholipids have a hydrophilic pole and a hydrophobic chain. And if you create these bubbles and shake them in a solution, they automatically formate bubbles or micelles. And the gas is inside. And there's a one important characteristic of these bubbles is that the size of these bubbles is quite well defined and is around 1 micrometer, a little bit larger, which fits quite well with the size of red blood cells. So this gives you very important characteristics of this ultrasound contrast agent. It's pure interluminal, a pure blood pool agent, which is very different to other agents you may know from CT or MRI. They are much smaller and extravasal agent. The size also has some relevant aspects for safety and efficacy. It has been discussed that especially larger bubbles with a larger diameter may have some concerns regarding side effects. And the size is also relevant for efficacy because these bubbles interact with ultrasound, and the size is determines how good the interaction works. I will explain it in the following. So the interaction with ultrasound is that the bubble starts to oscillate, which is understandable because an acoustic pressure or wave is nothing else than a phase of a positive pressure followed by a negative pressure. When the bubble, of course, expands during the phase of the negative pressure, and then it will be compressed and when the pressure is positive. And it, the oscillation follows, of course, the frequency you use in the, for diagnostic imaging, which is usually typically 1, 2, 3 megahertz. And the size or the oscillation is even better if the resonance frequency of the body of the microbubble has is in similar order like the ultrasound frequency you use. And this is exactly the case if the bubbles are in the size of 1, 2, 3 micrometers. So that's how they are designed. What you also need, should remember is that you can destroy such bubbles if you use high acoustic power, high MI ultrasound. And then the bubble is, of course, gone. The oscillation is a little bit more complicated, or what you need to understand that this oscillation is called nonlinear. What does it mean? It's caused by the fact that the enlargement or the expansion of the bubble is, of course, much easier than the compression of the bubble, because you can't compress it down to zero. It's more difficult, let's say, while expansion is, could be easy. That's why the the oscillation of the bubble is nonlinear. A symmetric behavior would occur only if you would use a very low MI ultrasound technique, which you usually don't use in medical imaging. This nonlinear behavior means that the echo you receive from such microbubbles is different compared to what you transmitted. So if you use, let's say, a well-defined ultrasound pulse, you get an echo similar to transmission only if you use a very low MI. That would mean your echo has the same frequency like the transmitted signal, the fundamental frequency, 2 megahertz, let's say. But in reality, in typical low MI, you get a more complex response. You get some subharmonics because of this nonlinear oscillation of the bubbles, which is the same like in a music instrument, you know, the simple and the complex tone. Some subharmonics are added. If you have 2 megahertz as a fundamental frequency, then you have 4, 6, and 8 megahertz. Okay, now we know in principle the how bubbles interact with ultrasound. How is this used to visualize? Which techniques are used for contrast sensor ultrasound imaging? The first technique that was a high MI imaging technique. And this works quite well, as you see in the images below. This is a very small experimental tumor with power Doppler. And you may believe without ultrasound, actually this tumor is actually not well vascularized. There are no larger vessels. But if you then add bubbles, which is here done in the right side, you see how well vascularized this tumor is. And you could really detect the bubbles. Now, how does it work? So usually you need a high MI, which means a high acoustic power technique. Power Doppler or color Doppler is such a technique. That's why it was used. And if such an ultrasound pulse hits the bubble, it will be destroyed. And this signal causes a very high, effect causes a very high signal. Actually, it's not so correct because therefore it's also called loss of correlation, because power Doppler actually measures the shift, the frequency shift. And this is visualized. The frequency, so it's a kind of artificial signal just because the bubble is lost, gone. So that's why the machine believes there's a high frequency shift. Okay, the next techniques are low MI techniques. They have the advantage that the bubbles are not destroyed. So otherwise, you would also always have to wait that the bubbles are again refilled in the area of interest, which is scan. If you don't destroy them, you can continuously monitor them. The first technique was harmonic imaging. Again, also not a technique which was specifically developed for contrast sensor ultrasound, but it can be used. Harmonic imaging is actually a technique to improve the image quality of unenhanced or B-mode ultrasound, because also tissue has a small nonlinear behavior. That means also tissue gives you some subharmonics back. And harmonic imaging exactly analyzed these signals, and what the consequence is that you analyze higher frequency. And you may remember that the higher the frequency in ultrasound, the better the image quality, the spatial resolution of ultrasound is. This was exactly the aim. So harmonic imaging improved the image quality of B-mode. But at the same time, you could also use this to detect the bubbles. So the bubble will give you much more subharmonics, as I explained before, so it will enhance the signal of bubbles. The disadvantage is here that you see the tissue and the bubble signal at the same time in the same image. Therefore, really contrast-specific techniques were developed, called, for instance, pulse inversion, to suppress the signal from tissue. And the pulse inversion uses two different pulses at the same time, and the second pulse is inverted or phase inverted. So if the first pulse has a maximum positive pressure, the second phase has a maximum negative pressure. And if those echoes are subtracted, actually you don't get anything anymore from tissue, because for the tissue it doesn't matter if the maximum is positive or negative. For a bubble, this is different. So if such two pulses hit a bubble, it makes a big difference if the maximum pressure is positive or negative, because as I mentioned before, it's much easier for a bubble to expand, to become larger in a negative phase, compared to the compression of the pulse. So that's why if you subtract those both echoes, you get a signal which is different from zero. The synonym for this technique is also phase modulation, is exactly the same. You can do the same separation if you modulate the amplitude. For instance, the second phase has an amplitude twice as high as the first. This also gives you a different signal from bubbles, but not from tissue. Or you can do a combination phase and amplitude modulation, and you could use three pulses at the same time, which is indeed realized in a technique which is called contrast pulse sequencing. You may know, for instance, in Siemens or Sequoia machines. So with such contrast-specific techniques, you're really able to separately visualize just the signal from the contrast and bubbles. And at the same time, you can also visualize it in normal B-mode. So, and this is what is usually done. You use such split-mode techniques where you have a signal, the contrast and ultrasound signal, and the B-mode at the same time. And if you want to do contrast and ultrasound, you need such techniques, which is not a problem. Nowadays, actually, all vendors have such techniques. Maybe this slide is not really updated because some slight modifications have been done in some vendors, but I don't want to compare techniques of different vendors. Anyway, just you, of course, you need and you can use contrast-specific ultrasound techniques. What is important to keep in mind is that you have a very sensitive detection of ultrasound contrast in real time. In the macrovascularization, of course, but also in the microvascularization, so you can really detect perfusion in real time. And just to show you how sensitive this can be, it's again a very small tumor. If you would use power Doppler, you wouldn't see any signal at all. But if you give contrast, then you see how well vascularized this tumor is. And you may even think that you can follow a single microbubble flowing through this ultrasound plane, which is indeed, in theory, feasible. You can detect a single microbubble if you use a very sensitive technique. Maybe a few pitfalls useful to mention, which are really nicely visualized by Dr. Torelius. So, of course, you can destroy the second-generation bubbles also with high MI ultrasound. So if your power is too high, you will destroy these microbubbles. And this is demonstrated here. So here, artificially, the MI will be increased. And what you will see is then, of course, the signal is gone, the bubbles are destroyed. They also remain in the large vessels, where always the refilling of bubbles is very fast, so the signal remains in this bubble, in these vessels. And then the transducer is rotated by 90 degrees, and you see how the ultrasound has destroyed the bubbles. This can be, let's say, sometimes a little bit tricky, especially if you don't have perfect ultrasound conditions, which is maybe quite often the case on a cirrhotic liver and so on. So a higher MI may be often the case in the near field. So there may be the acoustic power may be high, and it could be if your power is a little bit too high that you cause some bubble destruction in the near field. On the other hand, you can't reduce your power too much because then your penetration of ultrasound is too low, and then you will not get enough signal in the depths. So this again demonstrated here by Dr. Troelius. So here he started with a, let's say, relatively high MI, and the signal in the near field is, let's say, not so perfect. So it was reduced, and you may see the signal is now much better in the near field. On the other hand, now we have a problem with the penetration. So the signal in the depths is not so good anymore. So of course you should use always the presetting of your ultrasound machine, but let's say it also shows you that you may need to play around a little bit in a situation where you don't have perfect ultrasound conditions. In the next day, as Paul mentioned, you will hear a lot about the different indications. I just want to do some motivation. What can we generally do? Of course, liver remains the most important organ. Here we can really take advantage of the fact that you can sensitively detect the vascular morphology, the perfusion. This is especially important to detect and to characterize vascular lesion. Vascular imaging, not only to visualize, of course, larger vessels, it's especially useful also to visualize tiny vascularization, like in plaque imaging, also for detection of leakages of what we certainly will know also from Professor Kleber. Inflammation, all kinds of inflammation are useful indications for contrast ultrasound, because it means there's an increased perfusion of an organ, like here of a bowel or of a joint or whatever you want, and this can be then visualized with contrast ultrasound. I just made here a list which is probably not complete. As I mentioned, you can do it wherever you can use unenhanced ultrasound. And also Paul mentioned, of course, that most of these indications are then off-label, which is, of course, also important for us to mention as BRCO. This doesn't mean you are not allowed to do this. Sometimes you're even forced to use off-label indications of a drug, as you may know. And you will hear something about it tomorrow morning, which consequences this has for you. Just to mention that you can bubble not only intravenously, intravesical or intercavitary potential indications. Intravesical is an important indication for children, and especially to detect vesico-ureteral reflux to avoid radiation dose, which you usually would have to apply. Intervention, here just an example of an exotic case provided by Dr. Wermke. Here, bubbles not only were given intravenously, they were also applied intercurvature into this abscess. And what you see is that obviously the injection of bubbles showed that the drainage caused a problem, because now you see the bubbles not only in the abscess, but on the outside, the liver, so not very successful. Just another example, functional imaging, perfusion imaging of all kinds of organs, very, very common in echocardiography to assess myocardial perfusion, but you can do it everywhere outside in different organs, or here also even in skeletal muscle. Usually you need a kind of provocation for functional assessment. Here it was an occlusion method, and then you can assess the reduced perfusion reserve in patients with peripheral arterial disease. Therapy monitoring becomes certainly more and more important, especially in oncology with all the new anti-angiogenic drugs, where it is clear that the typical RECIST criteria are not very useful if you want to monitor the success of an anti-angiogenic drug. You need a method that visualizes perfusion, and contrast ultrasound can do this, and is obviously very useful. Very important here is that you need a kind of quantification of your method, and a standardization is really needed if you want to do a quantitative ultrasound. Also here you will hear something about quantitative ultrasound tomorrow. I just want to explain a few basics. So quantification or dynamic consciousness ultrasound means you typically analyze the signal over time curve after a bolus injection. So you keep your transducer at the same time and just measure the signal at the same in the same area, and you get to typically such bolus curves. And you can extract several parameters like the maximum, the time to maximum, area under the curve, and so on. All these parameters describe perfusion somehow, but they are not really directly linked to perfusion. They are more empiric or semi-quantitative parameters. And there's another method I would like to mention, which is much less known and common, is that you can also do an infusion of contrast agent instead of a bolus. Although this is feasible, there are even injectors are available where you can do a continuous infusion, and then you get a steady state of enhancement of bubbles. And then you can use a method which is called replenishment kinetics, which means you use in this destructive pulse, a high MI pulse, you destroy the bubbles in the area of interest, and then you observe the refilling, the replenishment of bubbles, which is here, just here shown in a very slow movie. And then you get different parameters. So you have the plateau phase, you destroy the bubbles and observe the refilling of the bubbles, and you get different parameters. These parameters are more related to perfusion. They are directly proportional, so not just empiric, which can be sometimes, if you really want to do perfusion quantitatively, can be an advantage. They even may give you more additional parameters like the skewness, which is a little bit complicated, but for instance, in antiangiogenic treatment, it has been found out that the perfusion itself doesn't necessarily change under antiangiogenic treatment. So what happens if you have a tumor, you have a lot of immature vessels, and the treatment may make the vessels more mature, more normal. The perfusion itself may not necessarily change. So the vascular morphology is the important thing what you may want to monitor. And such additional parameters may help to understand these things. As I said, standardization is really the key also for quantitative ultrasound, and software tools can really help to do this. And you may know that Bracco is also providing a tool which is called VueBox. It's has also a kind of motion correction, which may be helpful, especially if you want to analyze long videos. There's always motion. You get such fitted curves. You get the quantitative results. You can normalize it to normal tissue. Let's say you can give such color-coded maps, and it's a report is automatically printed out. And of course, if you want to do some research, you get access to the raw data. Okay, I think I can conclude. I hope I could show you that with contrast-sensed ultrasound, you have a really highly sensitive method to detect macro but also microvascularity in real time and with a high spatial and temporal resolution of ultrasound. So with that, it is really highly competitive to CT, MRI, or the other methods in diagnostic imaging. And therefore, you have all the various indications you will hear in the following all over the human body, you can say. Don't forget, sometimes it's off-label. But it's not just morphology. It's much more. You can do interventions, functional imaging, and so on. With that, I would like to thank you for your attention. And if you have questions...